A reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 22. After these things occurred, God tested Abraham, and he said to him, "Abraham, Abraham." And he answered him, "Here I am." He said to him, "Take your only begotten son Isaac, whom you love, and go into the land of vision. And there you shall offer him as a holocaust upon one of the mountains, which I will show to you." So Abraham, getting up in the night, harnessed his donkey, taking with him two youths and his son Isaac. And when he had cut wood for the holocaust, he traveled toward the place, as God had instructed him. Then, on the third day, lifting up his eyes, he saw the place at a distance. And he said to his servants, "Wait here with the donkey. I and the boy will hurry further ahead to that place. After we have worshipped, we'll return to you." He also took the wood for the holocaust, and he opposed upon it his son Isaac. And he himself carried in his hands fire and a sword. And as the two continued on together, Isaac said to his father, "My father." And he answered, "What do you want, son?" "Behold," he said, "fire and wood. Where is the victim for the holocaust?" But Abraham said, "God himself will provide the victim for the holocaust, my son." Thus they continued on together. And they came to the place that God had shown to him. There he built an altar. And he set the wood in order upon it. And when he had bound his son Isaac, he laid him on the altar upon the pile of wood. And he reached out his hand and took hold of the sword in order to sacrifice his son. And behold, an angel of the Lord called out from heaven, saying, "Abraham, Abraham." And he answered, "Here I am." And he said to him, "Do not extend your hand over the boy, and do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, since you have not spared your only begotten son for my sake." Abraham lifted up his eyes, and he saw behind his back a ram among the thorns, caught by the thorns, which he took and offered as a holocaust instead of his son. And he called the name of that place, "The Lord Sees." Thus, even to this day, it is said, "On the mountain, the Lord will see." Then the angel of the Lord called out to Abraham a second time from heaven, saying, "By my own self I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing, you have not spared your only begotten son for my sake, I will bless you, and I will multiply your offspring like the stars of heaven, and like the sand which is on the seashore. Your offspring will possess the gates of their enemies, and in your offspring all the nations of the earth will be blessed because you obeyed my voice." Abraham returned to his servants, and they went to Beersheba together, and he lived there. After these things occurred, it was reported to Abraham that Milcah likewise had borne sons for his brother Nahor: Uz the firstborn, and Buz his brother, and Kemuel the father of the Syrians, and Chesed and Hazo, likewise Pildash and Jidlaf, as well as Bethuel, of whom was born Rebekah. These eight Milcah bore for Nahor, the brother of Abraham. In truth, his concubine, named Reuma, bore Teba and Gaham and Tehash and Makkah. The word of the Lord. Hey everyone, welcome to Catholicism Wow. The story of Abraham is one of the most well-known Old Testament Bible stories, and there are a few different reasons for this. Number one, it was the birth of the Jewish religion. This is where Judaism begins. And because this is where Judaism begins, this is also where Christianity begins. Most people think Christianity begins with the resurrection and Pentecost. And to an extent, that's true. In a lot of ways, that's true. But in a lot of different ways, it also begins right here. This is where God instituted the sacrifice. The same sacrifice that we celebrate every Sunday, every day at the Mass. This is where God laid down the rules, basically, for how he is to be worshipped. God tells Abraham to take his son and to sacrifice him. And he's going to. He's going to, because God told him to. This is, for most people, a story about trusting in God above all things. That if you trust in God, even when you don't want to, even when you're not sure, even when it doesn't make sense, or even when it's going to hurt your heart and hurt your very soul, you trust in him anyway, and God will provide a way. Just as Abraham trusted in God, and God provided a ram to sacrifice instead of his son. And that's true. That is true. God was testing Abraham's faith. And we can all relate to that, because we all have felt like our faith is being tested. We all have felt like God is asking us to do something that seems impossible, or that we don't want to do, but we do it. We do it because we trust God. We do it because we trust that it's the right thing. But that's not all that's happening in the story. In the ancient world, child sacrifice was a real thing. It was common. And so that might have played into why Abraham didn't think twice about sacrificing his only son. To Abraham, he probably felt, well, it's my time now, I guess. It's my turn to sacrifice my son. Most people that have to sacrifice their children to God, they have more than one. This is the only one that I have. But if it's what God wants, then it's what God wants. There is a song by a contemporary Christian music singer called Clay Cross. And the song is called I Surrender All. And there's a line in the song that says, if all I have is all that you require, then I surrender all. And that's probably how Abraham was feeling. He was probably feeling like, if my only son, if the only thing I have in this world is what you require, then I'll give it to you. And he was prepared to do that. But God, in his infinite wisdom, in his omnipotence, in his godhood, saw that child sacrifice was occurring, and it wasn't what he wanted. God didn't want people sacrificing their own children to him. And that's something that we face now more than any time, because God is silent. God doesn't audibly say to us, Abraham, Abraham. He expects us to, he's given us his word. He's given us his word through sacred scripture and sacred tradition. And that way he's told us what he wants. But a lot of times we have to, especially in our own personal lives, we have to kind of guess what God wants. And at this point, when God was still revealing himself, when God was still teaching humanity how to worship him, he decided to do this so that he would leave the mark and say, hey, child sacrifice is not okay. It's not what I want. It does not please me. Sacrifice this ram instead, or this goat, or this sheep. And so God instituted the animal sacrifice. The animal sacrifice that stayed for thousands of years until Jesus Christ came and made the ultimate sacrifice, the final sacrifice, the sacrifice once and for all that we still celebrate every day at the Mass, every Sunday, every day at daily Mass. Every time the priest gets up at the altar and consecrates the Eucharist, we share in that once and for all sacrifice. And in a sense, we even share in that original sacrifice that Abraham made of the ram on the altar on which he was going to sacrifice his only begotten son, which again foretells Jesus, as Jesus was God's only begotten son sacrificed for all of us. So the story of Abraham has many, many, many layers. In a sense, it's God telling the Jews, his people, I don't want you sacrificing children. That doesn't please me. And another layer, it was God testing Abraham's faith, the same way that our faith is tested every day. And in yet another layer, it was a foretelling of the final sacrifice that would save us all. Thanks for joining me. This has been Catholicism Wow. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this passage and my remarks, my thoughts on the passage. Leave those in the comments section below. If you're not already subscribed to my channel, subscribe, like this video, share it with your friends if you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching, and have a nice day.